Good afternoon, everybody. This is Shivaun Palmer with the Plaid Girls. It is Wednesday, November 18th, and we are broadcasting live from Fort Worth, Texas this week. I have a fantastic guest, the lovely Victoria Wise. Mm-hmm. She's an amazing entrepreneur based here in Fort Worth. Victoria is the CEO of Wishing Well Jewelry Line, and she's also the co-founder of Show and Tell, a social media optimization company. Victoria, welcome.
Thank you.
Look, and so she's got her Plaid Girls on.
Yes, representing the Plaid Girls.
Yes, so. We look like a Jimi Hendrix cover album. Yes. All right.
Very nice.
All right, so let's start out. I always like to get a little bit of personal background from our guests. So tell me about yourself. Where did you grow up? Are you married, kids?
So I was actually born in South America.
South America?
Yeah, so my family is all from Ecuador, and I moved here as a baby, but grew up in Oklahoma, and then moved to Fort Worth to attend TCU, and have stayed in Fort Worth ever since because this is just where my heart is. I've been raising a family here. I've married for 8 years and have four children.
Four children. Go ahead, give us the ages.
So I have just turned 8, 6-year-old, and 4-year-olds. So a little busy, and started the business that really sort of kind of got me on the map with being an entrepreneur after having the twins.
Of course you did. That's how women roll. Okay.
It just sort of happens, and you just follow that
momentum,
and it worked.
Well, let's talk about just briefly that it was called Jewelry Nut Auctions. It really catapulted you, especially in the social media space. So tell us what happened.
So I got my feet wet doing production and design for women who were producing children's clothing on Facebook and doing an immense amount of business. And I was mentioning it to my previous business partner that this is what was going on, and found that my background with jewelry and accessories is what needed to happen on Facebook. And so we were the first to launch that category.
Wow.
And sort of exploded on the scene, and were able to hire, at the most we had 19 people working for us, and we had a CTO, and were developing software to help run our business.
And this was all off of a Facebook page?
All on a Facebook page, rather than actually launching a website. And so we caught the Facebook's eye, and we were selected. We were one out of 12 businesses out of 25 million at the time. I think there's a lot more now, but at the time, that's how many were active advertisers on Facebook, and they saw what we were doing and thought it was interesting. So we were flown out to Menlo Park to meet with their executives and talk about the platform and what we liked and what we didn't like, and help them work on products that they have launched and are launching.
Amazing. Okay, well, again, if people want to, they can Google you and get the much more specifics on that, because that was amazing. But today we want to talk about your current a jewelry line. Is called Wishing Well Jewelry Line. It says it's a jewelry company with a greater intention. So what does that mean?
So the sort of impetus, what fueled my fire with wanting to do something big and grow an idea into an enterprise level company, which is kind of my dream, is when I was working in the corporate world of jewelry, I had met with these two founders who had developed a jewelry line, and a home-based jewelry line. It was predating Stella & Dot, but they ended up selling their company for $600 million. And I met these women, and I thought, okay,
$600 million, okay.
They weren't, they were housewives. They just had a great idea, and they built it into something incredible. And so I was super inspired by that story, and having met with these women and producing products that were for their business, that was what has always sort of been driving me to build something. So with Wishing Well, when I was creating the jewelry line, I wanted it to be first beautiful jewelry that you would want to wear, and something that's had a modern approach to the design aspect of it, but be something that is meaningful to their wearer and could be, you know, an heirloom quality. So it chose sterling silver to work with, and gold-plated bronze. But the idea is that
I have one on right now. How beautiful is this? Yeah.
So what charm systems and traditionally have been, like, for example, James Avery, it's been about representing what you've done in the past in your life. So it's been where you've traveled, an organization you believe in, maybe it's something that symbolizes your birth month or, you know, year, or that sort of thing.
Sure.
This is about a charm system that works, that's future facing. It's what you want going forward in your life.
It's intentional. You're putting out, okay.
You're putting it out there that you want these things going forward. And it could be something very tangible, or it could be something that's just, you know, a bigger concept of just connecting with the right, you know, energy and people. So that is Wishing Well, and I launched the business. I did a soft launch in February and really received the product in June, and I'm working with new buyers to get it, and you know, I have the website, but get it into some more retail spaces. So
you will be brick and mortar retail, but you can also go online as well?
I will. It is just online right now, but okay. I'm working with distribution.
Okay. Yeah. And how are you inspired by the messaging? Where can people customize the message they want?
Yes, thanks
That's
for asking.
Yeah.
So what it is, everything opens, and all the pendants open, or the rings as well, and you put the charm inside that represents your wish or in your intention. And I have 30 different charms, and something can be something so specific for someone, like say the house charm, and it could be that you want to buy a house. It could be if you're a realtor and you want to sell more homes. It could be that you know you just want to have a safe, you know, happy place to raise your children. So that's how you can sort of customize the meaning of the charm. So I've hit with the 30 different charms. It's probably going to cover what your wish is.
I know recently you told me you went to New York City. How were you inspired by what you saw in that magnificent place?
I love New York. I think that one day I'll run away. I do know. I'm just kidding. I love.
Have you told your kids and husband this?
They would never do it. No, I do love Fort Worth, and this is home, and I don't have any plans to move. But I love New York to visit because it is such a place of inspiration.
Absolutely.
There's so much going
particularly
on.
Particularly with an artistic background, yes.
Yes, and so I visited. I'd never gone on the High Line before, and now there's a new Whitney Museum at the end of it. So I walked the length of the High Line and visited the Frank Stella exhibit that was curated by the moderns.
Yes.
Michael Upping. So I was so inspired by that visit, and have shared that message on the blog that I write too. About what we should do in Fort Worth.
It's fantastic. Yeah. Let's talk about the second business that you've launched as co-founder called Show and Tell. And this really intrigued me. It's called Social Media Optimization. I mean, there's so much out there right now, as you well know, on the World Wide Web. There's so much noise. So how do entrepreneurs, small business owners just launching a business, how do they optimize their social media efforts so they get the results they want?
So, you know, what we do, and we launched this business because we were turning away business. My partner in Show and Tell, her name is Lauren Foster, and she is a graphic designer and worked in branding for other businesses. And I had the social media background, having had a successful business launch and sale. We sold the company in October. So I knew how to utilize social media to grow an audience and make it really benefit your business. We were able to reach out to our networks and find clients and are running their social media. So we do it for larger businesses, but as far as in doing it as if you're an individual or small business, and what I've done also for myself is to plan ahead of time. Yes, it's wonderful to have the one-off, you know, I'm here, this is the situation, those are going to be fantastic posts. But if you can take the month and figure out what it is that you want your message to be, that's helpful. And then it doesn't give you that daily stress of how am I going to make this work? Because a lot of us are mothers or, you know, have businesses or work for other people, and it's just making that time for it. So I think if you do pre-planning of it, that's helpful. And then incorporate sort of the off-the-cuff moments in terms of content. In terms of audience building, it's always wonderful to network with other people who have larger audiences. I mean, I think that is a key.
That's a very large key to it, yeah.
I met with, while I was in New York, I talked to Natalie Friedman, and she has worked in New York and in LA and through with Us Weekly and through a Hallmark channel. She was a producer for a show on the Hallmark channel, and so she just launched last year a successful blog called Next Adventure, and her Instagram has done fantastic. And then what she found, even if she was being featured on an account that had a million followers, that really it was networking with people that are doing the same type of messaging.
Like-minded. They can support one another, sure.
And then tag each other's account in some sort of incentive for the follower.
Right.
So that is key. And I think if you start to follow those right accounts, that you can emulate some of the things that work.
And collaborate so that everybody grows exponentially.
Yes.
What do you think are the no-nos on social media, absolute things that you would tell people to avoid that could really be detrimental?
So recently the attacks in Paris happened, and I think that you definitely want to use that to be sincere and not to be to further your
own brand or your own message. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think that's kind of a tacky thing that can happen, but I think that, you know, other things is just showing outside of you that you want to craft that message so that it's real. And
very
authentic, if it comes across as too posed or, you know, overly agenda driven, then it's really not going to benefit you. I think you definitely need to kind of, you know, show the real aspects of your life.
That's fantastic. Yeah. So again, two great, going back to the sale of Jewelry Nut Auctions, you know, for people out there, this is a great lesson for a female entrepreneur. How did you learn how to, did you go to a business broker? How did you determine what the worth of your business was, and how did you go through that whole process? Was it challenging or?
To sell the business?
Yes.
Definitely. We did reach out to our initial networks to see if there was someone that was interested in purchasing, and then we found a business broker that was able to get us a lot of meetings and then to value the company. I mean, it was just strictly financials. I mean,
gotcha.
It's what we had done in the past and what we projected to have happen, and we were happy with the sale of the company.
Wonderful.
It still continues on. The new owner has renamed the business to Style Nut Boutique, but it continues on Facebook, and they also do some local pop-up style sales.
Fantastic.
So, yeah. And then with the next business, I ended up finding an investor to help me with
do some seed money to help you with the.
Yes, to put the website to. I mean, I built the website myself, but to get the product in hand and, you know.
Sure. That's always a big challenge for women in particular in terms of getting financing from a conventional bank. So sometimes you turn to angel investors or friends or family to start things.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. Okay, you know, we were talking about Plaid for Women, and one of our missions is No Mean Girls Allowed. So we got to put up our sign. Victoria and I have got to do our No Mean Girls Allowed. Let's talk about, have you ever experienced any mean girl behavior in your working life, or have any of your daughters experienced that in the school?
You know, thank goodness my daughter hasn't. She's pretty oblivious. She's the most free-spirited child. I wish I could have
that kind
nature.
Of,
yes, I think
spirit.
When I was little, I felt, you know, I just always thought there was a barrier into making friends, and it was imagined. And for her, everybody's a friend.
I love
and
it. She's very healthy,
yes,
mentally.
It is. I love that about her. So we haven't had that happen yet, thank goodness. But I know that it does happen, and I've heard friends talk about it, and it's kind of from unsuspecting other little girls that it's happening with. But I think as mothers, we really should be keen to it and
Absolutely.
Ask our peers, ask our other mother, like, is anything, you know, is she behaving the way that I would like her to behave?
It starts at home, doesn't it, though, in terms of learned behaviors
that? Definitely. I mean, you just kind of have to let your children be their own person. You cannot dictate what their lives are, you know, at all times.
Right.
I think you've got to
let them. Or live vicariously through them.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
But as far as within my own business, you know, luckily I've been in a very female-dominated industry, and I haven't had a lot of pushback with women. There have been some cases here and there, but as I shared in the blog that I write, that it is... it really just kind of fuels your fire to be even more focused in your efforts, in that you're doing this for this reason,
right.
Not to undermine anybody
another
else.
Person
yeah.
And there's an old African proverb that says my success is your success, and I think if women would really embrace that we can move forward so much more quickly.
Absolutely. I mean, it is about community over competition. It's collaboration. It's, you know, helping uplift other women and sharing how it is that you became successful, or the
Absolutely.
Initiatives that you're taking. Because it's not that it's going to lessen what you're doing or create more competition. It's going to help you.
It's going to move everybody forward. Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Victoria, this has been amazing. Before we close, I was wondering, could you tell me about any entrepreneurial heroes you have? Some men or women that you've looked up to, really inspired you to go out there and do all these amazing things as an entrepreneur?
You know, I really have to say that years ago when I was just starting, I really looked up to Martha Stewart, because I felt like she just had an amazing way to build her business.
She was.
So I think that's historically has been one. You know, most recently with the Facebook connection, I've been following a lot of what Sheryl Sandberg does.
Yeah, she's amazing.
And you know, I read Girl Boss, and what I respected how that she basically kind of hacked into that world with how it's Sophia Amoruso, how she was able to build a business, you know, from nothing, from kind of like with Jewelry Nut, we popped it up on Facebook, and you know, she was, you know, popping it up with MySpace and then on eBay, and then built this really big business, and then since launched that book. But I think it's people that kind of think outside of how
always,
those are the women that I I admire and try to learn from.
That's wonderful. Well, this has been an absolute pleasure having you on the Plaid Girls today. Victoria Weiss, Victoria, tell our audience the best way to get a hold of you and your two businesses, Wishing Well Jewelry and also Show and Tell.
You can connect on Facebook or LinkedIn, and then you can always...